The following program has been provided by the Pacifica Radio Archives Preservation and Access Project. For more information, call 1-800-735-0230 or log on to pacificaradioarchives.org.
For 6 years, from 1960 to 1966, Carlos Castaneda served as an apprentice to a Yaqui Indian brujo, or sorcerer, named Don Juan. During those years, Mr. Castaneda was a graduate student in anthropology at the University of California at Los Angeles. His experiences with Don Juan led him into a strange world of shamanistic lore, and psychedelic experience, and adventures in what Mr. Castaneda calls states of non-ordinary reality, some of which were frightening in the extreme, and all of which are fascinating in the extreme. His experiences with Don Juan are recounted in a book which has been published this year by the University of California Press called The Teachings of Don Juan, A Yaqui Way of Knowledge. Mr. Castaneda is with us here at KPFA today and has agreed to discuss the book and his experiences with Don Juan. Let me begin by asking you how you managed to meet this remarkable personality, Don Juan, and can you give us some idea of what sort of a person he is?
I met Don Juan in a rather fortuitous manner. I was collecting ethnographic data on the use of medicinal plants among the Arizona Indians, and a friend of mine who was my guide on that enterprise knew about Don Juan. He knew that Don Juan was a very learned man in the use of plants, and he intended to introduce me to him, but we never got around to do that. One day, when I was about to return to Los Angeles, we happened to see him at a bus station. And my friend went and talked to him, and then he introduced me to the man, and I began to tell him that my interest was plants, and that especially about peyote, because somebody had told me that this old man was very learned in the use of peyote. And we talked for about 15 minutes while he was waiting for his bus, or rather I did all the talking. And he didn't say anything at all. He kept on staring at me from time to time. And that made me very uncomfortable, because I didn't know anything about peyote. And he seemed to have seen through me. After about 15 minutes, you know, he got up and said that perhaps I could come to his house sometime where we could talk with more ease. And he just left. And I thought that the attempt to meet him was a failure, because I didn't get anything out of him. And my friend thought that it was very common to get a reaction like that from the old man, because he was very eccentric. But I returned again, and well, perhaps a month later, and I began to search for him. I didn't know where he lived, but I found out later where his house was, and I came to see him. At first, you know, I approached him as a friend. For some reason, I liked the way he looked at me at the bus depot. There was something very peculiar about the way he stares at people. And he doesn't stare, usually he doesn't look at anybody's tray in the eye, but sometimes he does that, and it's very remarkable. And it was more that stare which made me go to see him than my interest in anthropological work. So I came various times, and we developed a sort of friendship. He has a great sense of humor, and that eased the things up.
About how old a man was he when you met him?
Oh, he was in his late 60s, about 69 or something.
Now, you identify him in the book as a brujo. Can you give us some idea of what this means and to what extent Don Juan is connected, if at all, with some sort of an ethnic background, a tribal background, or is he pretty much of a lone wolf?
The word brujo is the Spanish acception, and it could be translated in various ways. In English, could render as sorcerer or witch, medicine man, or herbalist or curer. And of course, the technical word shaman. Don Juan does not define himself in any of those ways. He thinks of himself that perhaps he is a man of knowledge.
That's the term he uses, man of knowledge.
A man of knowledge. Or one who knows. He uses that interchangeably. And as far as his tribal allegiances, I think Don Juan is very much, I think his emotional ties are with the Yaquis of Sonora, since his father was a Yaqui from one of the towns in Sonora, one of the Yaqui towns. But his mother was from Arizona. Thus he has sort of a divided origin, which makes him very much a marginal man. Then at the present, he has family in Sonora, but he doesn't live there. He lives there part of the time, perhaps.
Does he have any formal livelihood? How does he earn his way in the world?
I wouldn't be able to discuss that. Rather, I don't think that I could at the moment.
Now, one point I'd like to clear up. It's something that I wondered about as I read the book. The book consists in large part of recordings of your own experiences using the herbs and mushrooms and so on, and that Don Juan introduced you to, and then long conversations with Don Juan. How were you able, just as a technical problem, how were you able to keep track of your experiences over such a long period of time? How were you able to record all of this?
It seems difficult, but since one of the items of the learning process is a recapitulation of whatever you experience, in order to remember everything that happened, I had to make mental notes of all the steps, of all the things that I saw, all the events that occurred during the states of, let's say, expanded consciousness or whatever. And then it was easy to translate them into writing after, because I had them all meticulously filed, sort of, and in my mind. That's as the experience itself goes. But then the questions and answers, I simply wrote them down.
Oh, you were able to take notes while you were...
Not at the very beginning of our relation, you see. I never took any notes. I took notes in a covert manner. I had a pad of paper inside my pockets, you know, my big pockets of my jacket. And I used to write inside my pockets. It's the technique, you know, that ethnographers use sometimes,
yes,
to take covert notes. And then, of course, you have to work very hard to decipher it while you're written.
Yes.
But it has to be done very quickly, see, very fast. As soon as you have time, you cannot postpone anything. You cannot let it go for the next day or something, because you lose everything. Since I think I work compulsively, I was capable of writing down everything that took place very, very shortly after the events themselves.
There, I must say that many of the dialogues are extremely fascinating documents. Don Juan, as you record his remarks, has a certain amount of eloquence and imagination.
Well, one say, it's very, he's very artful with the use of words, and he thinks of himself as a talker, although he doesn't like to talk. But he thinks that talking is his predilection, as other men of knowledge have other predilections, like movement, balance. He says talking. Thus it was my good fortune to find a man that would have the same predilection that I have.
Now, one of the things that's most impressive about the book is the remarkable chances that you seem to have taken under Don Juan's tutelage. That is, he introduced you to various chemical substances, some of which clearly, I suppose, could have been fatal if they had not been used carefully. How did you manage to work up sufficient trust in this man to down all of the concoctions that he put before you?
The way the book's presented, you know, it seems to heighten some sort of dramatic sequence, which is, I'm afraid, not true in real life. There are enormous gaps in between in which ordinary things took place that are not included. I didn't include it in the book because they did not pertain to the system I wanted to portray. So I just simply took them away, you see, and that means that the gaps between those very height states,
yes,
you know, whatever it is, since they are removed, it seems that it's a continuous crescendo, this kind of sequence leading to a very dramatic solution. But in real life, it was a very simple matter because it took years in between, it took months. Months passed in between them, and in the meantime we did all kinds of things. We even went out hunting. He told me how to trap things.
I
said traps were very old ways of setting up traps, and how to catch rattlesnakes, and he told me how to prepare rattlesnakes, in fact. And so that eases up, you see, the distrust or the fear.
I see. So there was a chance for you to build up a tremendous amount of confidence in this.
Yes, we spent a lot of time together, and then he never told me what he was going to do, anyways. And by the time I realized, I was already too deep into the event to turn back.
Now, the heart of the book, at least as far as my reading was concerned, certainly the most fascinating part of the book has to do with the. Your experiences with what you term non-ordinary reality. And many of these experiences, as you recount them, have a great deal of cogency to them. That is, they are experiences that seem to come very close to demonstrating the validity of practices like divination. And then on the other hand, you have experiences that at the time seem to have been tremendously vivid experiences of flight and of being transformed into various animal forms. And often you suggest a sense of some ultimate revelation taking place. What sense do you make of these experiences now as you look back on them all? Seems to have been valid about them, and how was Don Juan, do you feel, able to seem to control or predict what these experiences would be?
Well, and as far as making sense out of them, I think as an anthropologist, I could, the way I have done it, I could use them as grounds for set up a problem in anthropology, but that doesn't mean that I understand them or use them in any way. I could just employ them to construct a system, perhaps. But if I would view them from the point of view of a non-European man, maybe a shaman or perhaps a Yaqui, I think the experiences are, or they are designed to produce the the knowledge that reality of consensus is only a very small segment of the total range of what we could feel as real. If we could learn to code reality or stimuli the way a shaman does, perhaps we could elongate our range of what we call real.
What do you mean by that? How does a shaman like Don Juan code stimuli?
For instance, in the idea that a man could actually turn into a cricket or a mountain lion or a bird is, to me, this person, my personal conclusion, it's a way of intaking a stimuli and readapting it. I suppose the stimuli is there. Anybody who would take an hallucinogenic plant or a chemical, you know, produced in the laboratory, I think would experience more or less the same distortion, in quotes, because distortion of reality. But the shamans, I think, have learned through usage and in thousands of years, perhaps, of practice, they have learned to reclassify the stimuli and encode it in a different way. The only way we have to code it is as hallucination, madness. That's our system of codification. Mm-hmm. We cannot conceive that one could turn into a crow, for instance.
This was your experience under Don Juan's tutelage.
I cannot, as a European, I refuse to believe that one could do it. Mm-hmm. You see that, but.
But it was a tremendously vivid experience when you had it.
Well, it was. I could say, you know, it was real. Mm-hmm. That's my only way of describing it. But now to see that things over, if I will be allowed to analyze it, I think, you know, what he was trying to do was to teach me another way of coding reality, another way of putting it into a propitious frame that could, again, turn into a different interpretation.
I thought the passage in the book where these very different orientations toward reality that you had and Don Juan had, the point at which it came through, at least most clearly to me, was the point in which you questioned him about your own experience of apparent flight. And you finally came around to asking if you had been chained to a rock, would Don Juan still feel that you had flown? And his answer was, in that case, you would have flown with the chain and the rock.
Yeah. he alludes, you know, that I think what he meant to say is that one never really changes. You see, as a European, my mind is set. My cognitive units are set in the sense I would admit only a total change. For me to change would mean that a person mutates totally into a bird, and that's the only way I could understand it. But I think what he means is something else, something much more sophisticated than that. My system is very rudimentary, I see. It's not... it lacks the sophistication that Don Juan has, but I cannot pinpoint actually what he means by things. What he means that one never changes really. There's something else, another processes taking place.
It is difficult to focus on this. I think I remember Don Juan's line was, "You flew as a man flies," but he insisted that you flew.
Yes. Yeah.
There's another remarkable statement he makes, and it is. In the discussion of the reality of the episode, he says, that is all there is in reality, what you felt.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Don Juan is a very sophisticated thinker, really. It's not easy to come to grips with him. You see, I had tried various times, you know, to sort of wrestle with him intellectually, and he always he overcomes the victor. You know, he's very artful, and that they and he posed once the idea to me that the whole of the totality of the universe is it's just perception, and it's how we perceive things, and there are no facts, only interpretations, and those are nearly. I'm nearly quoting him, see, paraphrasing him as yes. close as I can. And perhaps he's right in that sense, or not perhaps he's right in that sense, is the facts are nothing else but interpretations that our brain makes, so stimuli. So if that's such, whatever I felt was, of course, the important thing.
Well, now, one of the aspects of what we normally call reality that seems most important to us is that of coherence or consistency from experience to experience. And I was impressed by the fact that the experiences you had under peyote seem to have, in your recordings, a remarkable coherence from experience to experience. I'd like to question you about this. There is an image that appeared in the experiences, which you call mescalito, mm-hmm. and it seems as if this image appears again and again with great consistency, that the general sense of the experience, the sound of it, the feel of it, is very much the same from time to time. Am I accurate in saying?
Yes, very, very much.
Well, how do you make sense of that fact?
Well, it's either that... I had two interpretations. Mine would be that it's product of the indoctrination I went through, those long periods of discussions and where instruction was giving.
Well, now, did Don Juan ever tell you how mescalito was to look?
No, not that look. Once I constructed, I think, the composite in my mind, the idea that it was a homogeneous and totally a protector and a very sturdy deity may have helped me to maintain that mental composite, or perhaps the deity exists outside of ourselves, as he says, completely outside of me as a man, as a feeler, and all it does is manifest itself.
Now, I thought your description of this image of mescalito was very vivid and very impressive. Do you think you could possibly, just to draw out one aspect of the book, describe what this figure seemed like to you?
Oh, well, it was truly an anthropomorphic composite. It was it was not truly a man, but it was not. It looked like a cricket, and it was very, very large. Perhaps larger than a man, and it looks somehow like the surface of a of the cactus, the peyote cactus, and that was the top looked like a pointed head, but it had human features in the sense of eyes and. And a face.
Yes.
But it was not quite human either. It was something different about it. And the movements, of course, were quite extraordinary because they hopped.
Mm. Now, when you described this experience to Don Juan, how did he deal with it? Was this the image?
No, he didn't care at all about my description of the form. He was not interested at all. I never told him what the form. He discarded it all. I wrote it down because it was quite remarkable for me as the man who experienced it. It was just extraordinary. It was truly a shocking experience. Thus, I record everything that I experienced. But insofar as telling him, he didn't want to hear about it. Mm-hmm. He said that it was unimportant. All he wanted to hear was whether I had, how close he let me come in this anthropomorphic composite at the time I saw it, you know, let me come very close. I nearly touched him. And that, in Don Juan's system, I suppose, was a very good turn. And he was interested in knowing whether I was frightened or not. And I was very frightened.
Mm-hmm.
But insofar as the form, he never made any comment, or he didn't even show any interest in.
I'd like to ask about one particular set of experiences. We don't have to go into them in detail here. I think we might simply tempt the listeners to look at the book and read the actual details of the experience. But your final experience with Don Juan is one of extreme fearfulness. Why do you think he led you into this final situation, at least final in your relationship with him, in which, I mean, he very literally seemed to scare the hell out of you? What was the purpose of that? It seemed almost, as you recorded, it seemed at points almost deliberate cruelty. What do you think he was up to when he did that?
When he had, previous to that last experience, right before it, he taught me some position that it's proper of shamans to adopt at moments of great crisis, the time of their death, perhaps. It's a form that they would adopt, and it's something that they would use. It's a sort of a validation. It's the signature, let's say, that or they prove that they have been men. Before they die, they will face their death and do this dancing, and then they will yell at death and die. And I asked Don Juan, you know, why would it be so important, you know, what, since we all going to die, what difference does it make whether we dance or we cry or we scream or yell or run? And he felt, you know, that the question was very stupid, because by having a form, a man could validate his existence. He could really reaffirm that he was a man, because essentially that's all we have. The rest is unimportant. At the very last moment, you see, the only thing that a man could do was to reassert that he was a man. So he taught me this form. And in the course of the event, this very frightening set of circumstances or actions, I was forced nearly to exercise this form and use it. It brought a great amount of vigor to me. And the event ended up there. Successfully, in quotes, I was successful in staying away from death or something like that. Or the next day, the next night, he took me into the bushes. And what I was going to do was, he was going to teach me how to perfect this form until it was neat. And in the course of teaching me, I found myself alone. And that's when this horrendous fear attacked me, really. And I think what he had in mind was for me to use this form, this position, this posture that he had taught me. And he deliberately scared me, I suppose, in order for me to test that.
I see.
And that was my failure, of course, because I really succumbed to fear. Instead of standing and facing my death as he was, I was supposed to, as a let's say apprentice of this way of knowledge, I became a thorough European man, and I succumbed to fear.
How did things actually end then between you and Don Juan?
They ended that night. I think, you know, I suffered a total ego collapse because fear was just too great for my resources, and it took hours to pull me back. And it seems that we came to an impasse. We had never talked ever again about his knowledge. That's almost 3 years ago, over 3 years ago.
You feel then he had finally led you up to an experience that was beyond your capacity to grapple with.
I think so. I think the I exhausted my resources.
I see.
And I couldn't go beyond that. And it's coherent with the American Indian idea that knowledge is power. See, you cannot play around with it. And every new step, say, is a trial, and you have to prove that you're capable of going beyond that.
I see.
So that was my end.
Yes, and yet over the 6-year period, Don Juan led you through a great number of terribly trying and difficult experiences.
Yeah, I should say I would, but he does not think that I have that I'm finished by some, I don't know, for some strange reason. He doesn't. He has never acted as though I'm through. He always thinks that it's this period of clarification.
Did he ever make it really clear to you what it was about you that led him to select you for this vigorous
process? He guides his acts by indications, by omens. If he sees something that is extraordinary, some event that he cannot incorporate into his possibly his categorization scheme, if it doesn't fit in it, he calls it a portentous event or an extraordinary event, and he considers that to be an omen. When I first took that cactus, Lufor Williams, the peyote, I played with a dog. It was a very remarkable experience in which this dog and I understood each other very well. And that was interpreted by Don Juan as an omen that the deity Mezcalito, Peyote, had played with me, which was an event that he had never witnessed in his life. Nobody has ever, in his knowledge, nobody has ever played with the deity, he told me. Thus, it was extraordinary, and something was pointing me out, and he interpreted as that I was the right person to transmit his knowledge or part of it or whatever.
Well, now, after spending 6 years in apprenticeship to Don Juan, what, may I ask, what difference this great adventure has made to you personally?
Well, he has certainly has given me a different outlook in life. It's enlarged my sense of how important today is, I suppose. I think, you know, I have I'm the product of my socialization. I, like any other person of the Western world, I have lived very much for tomorrow. All my life, I sort of saved myself up for another great future, something of that order. And it's only it was only with the terrible impact of Don Juan's teachings that I came to realize how important it is to be here now. And it renders the idea of entering into states to what I call a non-ordinary reality. Instead of disrupting the states of ordinary reality, they render them very meaningful. I didn't suffer any disruption or any disillusion with what goes on today. I don't think it's a farce. While I could say that I would have tended to think that it was a farce before, I thought that I was disillusioned, and I was an artist. So I did some work in art, and I felt, you know, that something was missing with my time. Something was wrong. But as I see it, you know, there's nothing wrong today. I cannot conceive what's wrong anymore, because it was vague to begin with. I never thought exactly what was wrong. But I alluded that it was a great area, that it was better than today. And I think that has been dispelled completely.
I see. Do you have any plans of ever seeking out Don Juan again?
No, I see him as a friend. I see him all the time.
You still do?
Yes, I do. I'm with him. I have been with him lots of times since the last experience I narrated in the book. But as far as seeking his teachings, I don't think I I would. I sincerely think that I don't have the mechanics.
One final question. You make a heroic effort in the book to make sense of Don Juan's worldview. Do you have any idea of whether Don Juan took any interest or takes any interest in your worldview, the one you're calling that of a European man?
Well, no, I think he's versed. Don Juan's very versed in what we, the Europeans, stand for. He's not handicapped in that sense. He makes use. He's a warrior, and he makes use of his... he sets his life as in a strategic game, and he makes use of everything that he can. He's very versed in that. My effort to make sense of his world is... it's my own way of, let's say, paying back to him for this grand opportunity. I think if I don't make the effort to render his world as a coherent phenomena, he'll go by the way he has for hundreds of years as a nonsensical activity. When it is not nonsensical, it's not fraudulent. It's a very serious endeavor.
Yes. Well, the outcome of your experiences with Don Juan is a really fascinating book. After reading it myself, I can certainly recommend it to the Pacifica audience. It is an adventure in a very different world than we ordinarily live in. I'd like to thank you, Mr. Castaneda, for making this time available to talk about the book and about your adventures. This is Theodore Roszak.
Thank you.